position dynamics come from the work made. So how and so then this model of population dynamics where you have a solid jet driven by some universal map, something somewhere like that. Okay, so the model of May was just a population which is described by a single parameter of the size of the population, and it's a discrete time system where it gives the population of 1 year just in function of the last year. And so you have something which looks like that. It looks like a unimodal map. We know that if here the map is high enough, you should get some kind of cloud dynamics at least for most values of the parameters. So what I have to explain to you is some more sophisticated models, say, and I happen to work on this because my brother is a biologist, and so he's part of the team in the Oslo University. So he's part of a team who is headed by Professor Stenfeld. This is in the biology department of Oslo University, and I spent some time there to discuss ideas with them. I should say right now that there is more, the mathematical content of the model is more, of the talk is more in potential than actual. I mean, we will see that. Some numerical evidence that there is something interesting happening, and one should try to prove some theorems, but these theorems are not proven yet. Okay, so let's start with biological observation. The population we are talking about are small rodents, typically bones or lemmings. And the region is northern Scandinavia. One of the places they are looking at is Finnberg. Norwegian name is Svalbard. Which is point to the north, so 84 or 85 degrees of latitude. So these populations are quite confined, and they have looked at time series for these populations. The oldest time series are something like 100 years old. So it's a kind of a classical phenomena in population dynamics, a classical problem if you want. But you should immediately understand that these data, the data that they get, are not anything like physical data, in the sense that what you get is some data, more something like 3 or 4 times a year. It's not real continuous data if you want, I mean it's just because you have to go there and spend some time there just for one data. And also, there are big problems of methodology about getting this data. Because this small rodents live under the earth, and so you have to to count them is a difficult problem, and the typical method is what is called capture-recapture techniques. So you just try to get them into traps, and then you identify them, typically cutting some of their fingers, and releasing them. No, it's not, I mean, it's supposed to be not... the point that there are 10 fingers, so it allows to count more than 1,000 different individuals. Okay, and to identify them, the way to identify them. And then a couple of days after that, after you have you try again to capture them and estimate the proportion. But then you know which proportion of the, at the second time you did capture the first time. And from that you should be able to estimate the total population. Okay? Only there is a BR because you have taken them the first time, there is a it's not independent of capturing them the second time. So there is a kind of bias which is difficult to estimate. Well, all this, no, I mean, just to say that it's not a trivial fact. To count them is a difficult thing, and they don't expect something which is more than this is an error pattern. This is an estimated pattern. The error that they assume that they do is something like of the order of 40%. Okay, which is not. It's just to say that what you will get at the end of this data is not a nice curve. In terms of time, but only a few points, each of them determine up to a 40% value. So it's not nothing very precise. You should also be, the statisticians say that even for the population, human population of the United States, there is an error of the order of 5 billion people. So it's not, even for humans, it's not that easy to count people. They're just cutting them in order to be. Okay. Now, okay, so this is to obtain the data is a difficult process, and it's one of, I mean, it's a parenthesis, but it's one of the problems of this field is that it's so much easier to study models, mathematical models, just putting them in the computer, than to go to the field and get real data from the real world. That it's a problem in the field that many people go to the numerics and do not go to the field. Okay, anyway, what are the observations? What are the observations? What you get is very strong irregular oscillation. Oscillation, it's not oscillation around an equilibrium in the sense that if you look at look at a given time of the year, say 1st of June, okay, because this, as you guess, in this part of the world, the winters are quite strong and it makes a difference whether you measure the population in winter or summer. But typically they don't go there in the winter. So just consider the observation at a given period of the year, say June, and look at the max and the mean of the observation, then they get something which is of the order of 1,000. Okay, so really strong oscillations. And the density can go from 50 to 50,000 in the same per one hectare in French. So this is, and the time, the period of this oscillation, which are not regular, as I said, it's not just a periodic motion, this period is of the order of 3 to 5 years. So between consecutive, say, maxima or minima, but this minima or maxima are not really very regular, so it's really something like wild oscillation like that, with no periodicity Okay, so I want to write now a mathematical, mathematical equation, which we hope has some relation to this phenomena, but it's certainly not proven. I should say just that the basis explanation for this oscillation in words should be that there is a coupling between the fact that this population has a very high fecundity when the circumstances are very good, and the fact that the fecundity goes down in a rather dramatic fashion, where the density is high. Actually, that's the density, high density, provokes some stress in the population, which has a strong effect on the fecundity. Okay, now let me write the model. So I will first write. In the equation or in the reality? No, I mean, this is really observed in this condition. For instance, they are studying, my brother in particular, they are also studying this population of wolves and lemmings in the Alps. And in the Alps, they do not observe the same phenomena. So, I mean, it's really characteristic of northern Scandinavia and also in Canada. But, I agree with this question in the following. There are actually two. You can try to explain this irregular oscillation in two ways. Putting some, stochastic thing in the input, so typically putting a stochastic input in the climate, or getting the stochastic, the chaotic behavior from the equation with a determined. So the question is not resolved.
The problem is,
there is certainly no variation. This 3 to 4 year cycle is certainly not observed in the climate. So, I mean, you have at least this kind of cycle, you have to say, I mean, does not come from the climate. What could come from the climate is the fact that the oscillation is irregular. So you should have, but it's kind of more difficult to, I mean, you have some points like that. So you have to take just the maximum and correlate. This has not been done as far as I know. But actually, it's more complicated than that, but because I understand that the winter is also variable, and you should, I mean, try to average something, and it's not clear what to average. I guess that you are right in the sense that the main question is whether this phenomena, which is observed, comes really from some chaotic behavior in the data, in the input, in the climate, say, or it really comes from the equation, from the dynamics. This equation, I have no answer. There is a suggestion, yeah? Yeah?
The climate is chaotic, but it's awesome.
This is definitely not true. I mean, there are these strong oscillations, and the reason for the oscillation is what I told. The question is at the second level whether the fact that there is a larger oscillation or a weaker oscillation is related to climate. That the oscillation occurs over a period of 3 or 5 years, not just one. I mean, so you should average in some way the climate over the 3 to 5 years and try to correlate, but it's not that easy. I mean, it's not easy what exactly to correlate. Anyway, I don't know the answer. So let me write the equation. So I will explain everything. Just write that equation. And explain what are these equations. Now first, n of t is, so the main is the solution that we are looking for, is Fermi mature population density. Time t. You just look at the Fermi's because you produce and those which are old enough. And so mature means with age larger than this A dot which appears here. So A dot is the age of maturation. This equation A is age. And A1 is the maximal lifespan. And we give a numerical value afterwards. Okay, now we have still two functions here. So n I explained, A0 and A1 I have explained. So t is time, a is age, s is survival rate. M, two arguments T and N, this is time and this is density, this is the fecundity rate. So in the first equation is a kind of obvious, I mean, tautological equation, just saying that the population at time T, you have to look at population mature, population at time t minus a over all age a since that they are old enough. So you look at this population and multiply by the fecundity to get the number of births and integrate over age taking the survival rate into account. Okay, so this is a kind of tautological equation. Sorry? I will come back to the numerical values at all. Okay, I'm just trying to because there are other numerical values which go. So this is kind of tautological, just counting the population from the number of births and the survival rate. And this is now not tautological, this is part of the hypothesis which is given by the biologists, but I mean even slightly counterintuitive for mathematicians. The point is that the effect, what I'm claiming here, what the biologists are claiming, is that the most important effect on the density is not on the mortality, but is on the fecundity. My reflex would be to put the effect of high density on the high mortality rate, but let's tell that it's more important. More important effect on the fecundity, so which is written here. So, N0 is the fecundity in perfect, say, the ideal circumstances, meaning in the summer with low density. And you have two effects which are getting this fecundity down. This is the seasonal factor. And the other one, MD, the density dependent factor. And this is actually the only place in this density dependent factor where the equation will be nonlinear. If this was just a constant term, independent of the density, then the equation would be a linear equation and would not be interesting. I mean, certainly would not present the phenomena that you here. Okay, now let me be more specific. I will be more specific about the values and the. So, here at the moment I have three parameters, numerical parameters which are A0, A1, and M0, which are three constants, and three functional parameters which are the function S. The function ms and md. So it's too much to make a numerical study. So what you know is that so I will get rid of the functional parameters taking some specific functions, numerical parameters, like far from only choice. So the S, by lack of better, it's nice to take it from the mathematical basis, and there are no good arguments to take something else. So you just take the most simple function, which goes from one age, survival rate, so it must be one at age zero. This is the maximal lifespan, so just take the fine map. I don't have any more parameters, I take it the parameter A1, but no extra parameter. Then the two other functional parameters, it's a slight, certainly a simplification, but the seasonal factor, it just depends on one parameter O, which is the length of the winter. And just take assuming that this reproduction stops in the winter, and it's good in the summer. Actually, you should probably take something which is with a slight transition like that, and something which is not absolutely zero, since there is a very, very low, but some reproduction in the winter, but very low anyway. So, this at least is the first approximation what one would like to do. And the third one, is the density dependence that we have. So, it's reasonable to take something which is constant, value 1, but just a factor, constant with value 1 up to 1 population. If the density is low but not too high, then there is no stress coming from the fighting for food, looking for food. So, it's essentially 1. And then, from one given value that you scale to be 1, you scale the population so that this critical value is 1, then it goes decreasing. So, and well, now there is no real reason to take this function to be anything special. I mean, certainly it should decrease. To know whether you want to take a power law, an exponential, or anything else, they don't have any argument in any direction. And so we choose to take this as a power law, let's say, with a parameter which is a gamma. So gamma is a parameter. We will discuss later the value of the parameter. So making this assumption in the model, we have now 5 numerical parameters, which are A0, E1, rho, the length of the winter, and 0, the fecundity in perfect circumstances, and gamma. Now, what are the values of those parameters? It's still given by biology in some sense, except for gamma. So A0, the maturation age, is around 1 month, and we will count in years, so it will be around 0.1, something like that, 1 month. A1 is the total lifespan, is the order of 2 years. Rho, the length of the winter in proportion of the total year, it's a long winter, right? Something like 7 or 8 months. M0, and this is important. I mean, these rodents have a very high fecundity in good circumstances. With the units I did take, it's something of the order of 50, and this means that every female, mature female, has every month has descendants 3 to 4 females every month. So it's really an exclusive reproduction when the density is low. And the gamma, well, the gamma is absolutely no reason to think that it has any particular value. So I mean, esprit pris par un moteur électrique. There are not really able to check that. I mean, I should say that at every point where they did not have any information, I was taking just the simplest thing to put. Well, actually, this kind of equation has been looked at, not exactly this one, but similar equation have been looked at before. No. This is one of the points for this Pittsburgh thing, for instance, where you look in a completely isolated environment, and there is no spatial phenomena, because people have looked at this kind of equation, but also with a spatial repartition of the population. But in the Pittsburgh, for instance, they are completely confined in a rather small area with the densities rather uniform, so there is no diffusion process, for instance. But there are also no predators, and I mean, the only factor is the competition for food. And the stress that engenders on the population of the community. And I should say that this kind of, I was very specific about the population model to begin with, because the population dynamics are very different if you look at some species and some other species. I was cods, for instance, for cods, this is a much more stochastic process of production, because one female cod could have as many as 60,000 descendants, and the other ones are sterile. So, I mean, it's a really stochastic thing which you have to modelize. Here it seems more regular path, deterministic process, in a sense, less stochastic. So, now, let me just give now a few general considerations. And after that, some numerical result on this equation. So the general considerations are not going very far, but at least just to say that you have a nice attractor. This is very easy to prove. The point is then to study the attractor. But the fact that you have an attractor is a very easy thing. Well, let's first define the phase space. You have a dynamical system, so you take the time to be periodic. One is 1 year. So take T0 in the torus, and then define the space of. So it's a space of function n, which are continuous from the interval -1 to +. So continuous, and which satisfies one condition, which is actually the equation that you see here, but written at say 0, so it's n of 0, it's so one relation, integral from 0 to 1, of s of a, n of minus a, and the last is m of minus a, no, sorry, t0 minus a, n of minus a. I could say this you could think of after some modulation by the survival rate as the age pyramid that you see at some given time. At the time zero, you see an age pyramid which go from age zero to age A1. And using the survival rate, I mean, this is more or less the same as this function n, and you are describing the, so, and this will depend on the time of the year that you look, and there is a relation between the number of births, essentially, and the pyramid that you see. Okay, so this is a hypersurface in this space of, open set because this function has positive values in the space of continuous function. And now you have a semi-flow is not invertible, but which preserves this space. So if you want to use this XT as fibers of a phase space over R over Z, and then you have a vector field on this phase space, flow, a semi-flow on this phase space, the orbits are transverse to the vibration. Now, so this is for phase space, and you have the semi-flow. The next point is just to observe that if you give some a priori estimates, so let me write this. I'm looking now at a compact subset of this thing, compact for the C0 topology. So I'm assuming on one side.
Still, where does X be zero?
Yeah, this will just be the restriction. If I'm starting. I need to start integrating the equation. I have the equation here. Okay, the equation was relating n of t in terms of parameters and the value, this function for a between a0 and a1. It will be a delay equation. Okay, so knowing this, I know this. So to start moving, I need to know the function n of such an interval. The initial value, the set of initial value for the equation is such a step. Now it depends, the T0 is because I can start at any period of the year, I can start in the summer, I can start in the winter, and this is just this T0. I am given the age pyramid at a given period of the year, at some given time. Then I start integrating the equation. This is the initial value I need, and so this is just the phase space. The phase space is the set of T cross XT, the union over A over Z. This was this X space. So this is the phase space. And in the same way, I'm given a compact subset. Where I'm looking at function m in x, so this is what here, m in x. So two conditions, one on the C0 norm, it says that, this is for all n. I will write it. Function m should have a bounded Lipschitz constant, and there are three relations here, three constants, C0, n max, and L, which are explicit. N max in the model, n max, for instance, is something like m0, a1, over 2. The values are in that thing, but you have similar formula for L and C0. Just to say that for quickly explicit, you actually need to have a high density, and this is satisfied for this population. You need for the fecundity to be rather high in relation to this value. C0 at n max. C0 is 1 minus rho, 1 minus 0 plus 1 plus 0. This is an explicit value that you can compute in this particular model. L0 is really large enough, easily large enough for this set. This is a condition to guarantee that actually the population does not just vanish. If the fecundity ideal circumstance is not good enough, then the population will just disappear because it does not reproduce in the winter, and I mean, it just collapse. So, provided that the population is high enough, the fecundity is high enough in the summer, and then the population will not disappear, because actually this compact set will be invariant. As you can see that in this compact set, the composition is bounded from below. And not only is this compact set is invariant, but it will attract everything in the initial fast phase space. And so we get an attractor, lambda, defining K as the union of T cross KT as before, in the phase space X. Then you just get an attractor taking the intersection of opposite times of T minus T of K. Okay, so just to get, and so this is a nice compact connected. Everything is compact because of the Lipschitz condition in the C0 topology. And you are really interested in the dynamics on this invariant set. Unfortunately, this is more or less all we know from the theoretical point of view. So let's go back to the numerics. As I told, or if I didn't tell, I'm telling this now. This is very much a work in progress, and we still need to work a lot on this model. So in particular, we did not explore by all means all the parameter space, which anyway we have five parameters, which is a large parameter space. Also it's not so short to solve the equation and just one value of the parameters to get a solution. So what we did, actually what happens is that the function gets smoother and smoother. I should have explained that. Yeah, what happens really, and why you get this, is actually that, perhaps not completely if I've taken exactly this model with angles, but actually that I'm taking some smooth version of this, say it's infinity. And then actually, even starting with non-smooth data, say just continuous, then the solution will get to infinity after some time. It starts continuous and it is infinity. So I've just chosen to put Lipschitz estimates. Actually, you will have, say, 2, C, 3, C, 4 estimates if you want. The point being, not from a mathematical point of view, but from a biological point of view, if you want, if you have a small oscillation like that in the age pyramid, in the age structure of the population, a small localized oscillation, which just smooths out at the next generation. It does not make any difference at the next generation whether the mother was exactly 1 year or 1 year and 2 days old. We just smooth out by reproduction. I don't know if it's clear. I mean, it's intuitively clear that, yeah, this integral, I mean, it's clear also from real life. I mean, that the distribution, I mean, if you don't have extra phenomena like the wars or something like that, that the age population could be something that is smooth, just a convolution operation. So we started with values that you will see are not exactly this one, unfortunately. This is one of the problems with the models are not completely in accordance with the biology. And what we did is taking a time step, so we discretize the equation, and the time step is of the order of 3 days. The total, and we integrate over something which was of the order of 10,000 years. The equation. And we just look after that at the times which are between, say, 1,000 years, just because you take some random initial condition, random, reasonable, positive, blah, blah, blah. But there is no reason, it's impossible to pick a point on the attractor to begin with. You don't know exactly where is the attractor, so just pick some point in the phase space, and then integrate the equation for 1,000 years hoping to get close enough to that factor after 1,000 years, and then plot what happens after that. Now you are not interested in plotting this kind of, I mean, you just see something which is like that, it's not very interesting. What you plot rather is you plot at such a point in free space. So let's refine this. So t here should be a continuous variable, but actually you just put them for t integer. I'm just plotting 9,000 points in R3. If you want, where in an infinite dimensional space, you have this attractor in infinite dimensional space, but you are hoping for this attractor to be finite dimensional and not to finite dimensional, I should say, and also with the finite dimension not too large. If the dimension is less than 3, you have a good chance to see something in projecting in R3. Okay, actually, the point is that you see something here, because otherwise I would not look here. So what you see, so the object is here, and so what you see, I'm not applying mathematician, so I have not nice pictures to show you, but just on paper, and it's really not spectacular. But you certainly see something like that. So it's a picture in R3 that you can turn around, and it looks like something which is not sitting in a two-dimensional space, but if you just turn around, it looks like that. Really something like Enon. Rather two-dimensional, it's really like the Enon. So it looks like one-dimensional. I will come back to that. But it looks like one-dimensional, but with a kind of transverse contour structure also. So it looks like I know a factor, the same kind of picture that I used to see. Just 9,000 points. And once again, I'm not claiming that to be able to prove anything yet. I should give the parameters for which you prove that. So the real parameters for which this is 2, because we just move, actually this was kept fixed in the, and this was kept fixed also. This was kept fixed because really, alors this was slightly too small, and only 2. And this, alors this was of the order of 8. So for these values, and this it was, so for the yellow values of the parameters, we did observe something like that for this 9,000 points in free space. And not only it looks like that, if you can look at the next point, I should say that I plotted here the x2t. There is a period 2 underlying phenomena, so you have another, if you want, the odd, the even t are here, the odd one with this similar picture in another part. So this is a half of this point here, the odd one, say. And then it's not only that it looks like that, but say if one point is here, the next one is here, and the next one is here. So I mean, you do not only recognize the Enon from the geometrical point of view, but also from the dynamical. Very far. I mean, n is positive. It's a three-dimensional picture. I'm not able to draw it. it's rather, I'm not sure that I understand your question. I was thinking about the empirical data. I'm not claiming that it's as big here. I will come back at the end to do what is still lacking in the model. I'm not claiming that just this data explains completely the initial phenomena. First, because you have a period 2 underlying thing here, as I said here, which does not correspond exactly to the 3 to 5 period that I was speaking at the beginning. I mean, there are still many lacking, lacking, but also the model is a kind of simplistic model with relation to the real-life system. So it would be a first step towards explaining the real-life phenomena, but certainly not the full story. I'm not sure that I'm answering the question, but I'm not able to tell you exactly. I should say that this is just one value of the parameter. We did observe some other interesting attractors for other values, which are not exactly this. It could be of the same class as Enolite, but with a different geometry. It looks one-dimensional like that. So something which looks like Eno, but the geometry, something like that, it could be something which is, comes from one dimension, but with a different geometry. So, I mean, I want to explain. I cannot explain from the biological point of view why high is positive, because I was trying to discussing with them that they don't have any idea what exact shape. They just take some function like that and just don't know anything about it. They are not able to measure this phenomenon directly. It's reasonable that up to some critical level, there is no stress from the competition for food. I mean, just more food that these rodents are able to digest. So, I mean, to have a constant value here seems perfectly reasonable for them. The point is to know which kind of certainly you have to smooth out. I mean, this is just to be able to make some computation. This is an explicit thing which allows to do some computation, but most of the qualitative theory, I mean, the point is, if you get some Enon-like thing, it should have some degree of stability. So if it happens for this, you certainly can smooth things like that, or that, etc. So what I said is, you need a model that should be simple enough to integrate. So this is a property. If you start smoothing out, integration becomes difficult, and you probably don't get anything really new. Now, about the exponent gamma, I have some heuristic, it's more than heuristic, to explain why you should take gamma large, but not too large, actually. So let me come back. You first look at the unseasonal model. This means that you assume, so it's really from the mathematical point of view, because you assume that there is no winter. Just because in this case, the equation is simpler, you have a time independent phenomenon. And now, what you get, and you have a station, you have an equilibrium, constant solution, which is given by this value. So this is a value for the equilibrium population in the unseasonable model. Now, if you just, so you look at the stability of this equilibrium, and so this leads to consider the Laplace transform f of lambda of the survival rate. Because of the explicit value of s, but I mean, it's not really related to this explicit value. But, I mean, if you want something numerical, that some combination of exponential. is the Laplace transform, and the eigenvalue for the equilibrium are given by, so you want to solve, so this is an entire function, and you want to solve f of lambda is equal to the following value, c gamma, which is by definition a 1 over c. So this does not depend on gamma, and does not depend on this function, only depends on the survival rate, for every survival rate, we have some expression. And then the dependence of gamma comes from this equation here that you have to solve. And this value is a 1 over 2, 1 minus a 1 over a 1 squared, times 1 minus gamma minus 1. So you see, if gamma is large, this term here will be quite small. You are close to solve a lambda equal to 0. Now, you are interested to know in the complex plane how many solutions of this equation are on this the right-hand half plane here. And these are the attracting eigenvalues, these are the stable eigenvalues, these are the unstable eigenvalues. And so what you look is, you look at this equation, the imaginary part of f on the imaginary axis, I times u, u is real, is zero. So you get some solution, so this is not difficult for large, some combination of cosine and sine. So you get a symmetric sequence of values u1, u0, u2. Symmetric. And now you discuss the values at the IUK, and they happen to be decreasing. So it's called this gamma, not gamma zero. Okay. Going to zero. Now, you see that so this corresponds to the value of C, so just inverse this before. You get gamma. If you write these values to be C gamma zero, you get some values of gamma. Same here. And the values of gamma which correspond are this time increasing. Now the point being that unless for gamma less, if you have to say gamma less than gamma zero, the equilibrium is stable. Then for gamma zero, at gamma zero you get an Hopf bifurcation. Actually the two eigenvalues will cross at these values u0, we cross the imaginary line here, and we have just a pair of unstable eigenvalues, and all other eigenvalues being stable. Two unstable eigenvalues, etc. So getting a new pair of unstable eigenvalues, and each time you cross given values of this gamma here. Now, if you compute, this value is of the order of 6.2. So it means that, at least in the unseasonable model, the equilibrium was stable for all values gamma less than 6.2. So you need really something rather happening. I agree that it is unseasonable here, and with the seasonal dependency here. But still, in the unseasonable model, you have a really strong stable equilibrium up to 6.2. And then, the next values here, gamma 1 is of the order of 30. So it means that between these two values, in particular for 8, but for large values of gamma here, you will get just a pair of unstable eigenvalues, suggesting that the dynamics in the attractor should take place in some two-dimensional space, which explains more or less all the hard space. This is related to having the NO attractor here. So this was the unseasonable case, which means that you have a vector field. It's non-dependent on time. When you put back the seasonality, then you get a discrete time model, and then you should get a discrete thing in two dimensions. I mean, it's not a rigorous statement, but it suggests why you should see some two-dimensional phenomena in this infinite dimensional phase space, at least for this kind of values of gamma. Now, so I would like also now to try to explain what one would like to do on the mathematical side, and also what the biologists would like to do. So what time? Perhaps just let me mention before that, one of the other evidence that there is some, numerical evidence, but there is some inner thing like that, is that what you can take is some small box around in some part of the attractor, right? So you are looking at this 9,000 points in free space. Just take a small box in free space, a box which is not too small in the sense that it contains something like 30 points in the small box. And then, looking at these 30 points, you integrate, on one side you integrate forward, and the other side you integrate backwards. Just looking at the points which are following this 30 points. So, because sine t is sine t plus 2, okay, because you are looking, you choose the points to be close together, the trajectory between t and t plus 2 are very close. It's just by choice. But when you integrate forward, you see something which is going like that. I mean, just going in a rather uniform way and separating. That exponential rate is exaggerated because you cannot measure the thing very well. But looking like that. But if you integrate backwards, then you get something like that, where half or a large part of the trajectory stays together, and the other also stays together. And then later they separate again in two parts or three or anything like that. But I mean, you really see a contour-like structure in this backward trajectory, which is related to the fact that in the inner attractor, you have continuous in unstable direction. It's a line, it looks like a line, and in the stable direction, so integrating backwards here, looks like a contour set. So you really can see that in the numerical data. And the contour-like structure backwards here, and the continuous structure forward. It's not very precise, but I mean, it's certainly well, easy to see. So what you would like to do? You expect that the geometry of the equation is really the one in infinite dimension is look like the one that you have for the Eno half. So you would hope to have the following. So some tube where you have a one-dimensional straight line, something which is a curve which is one-dimensional in this direction with expansion along the curve and a tube around the curve. So this is dimensional, the other directions, and you hope that this tube should go inside itself, pinching in a transversal way, and also folding at some point part of the tube. This is the geometry that you would like, but to prove that the equation has this geometry, what we look here is just the attractor, it's not the neighborhood of that. And it's also in three-dimensional space, and there's plenty to do from just this picture, to put this picture in a space space. So you would like to prove for the equation that it has this kind of geometry. This is the first photon map for after one period, after 1 year. So it's a discrete time dynamical system. The initial equation is continuous time, but you integrate over 1 year. You get a discrete time dynamical system, and one would hope for this kind of geometry in the infinite dimensional phase space. And then, even if you are able to prove the geometry, you still need a theorem for the existence of a non-like attractor in this setting. Because there are at least two problems. The Bon, ça faut être sérieux, ce second moment tu vois, c'est le first. The first problem is that Hainaut attractor has been fully proven as a resistance of the Hainaut attractor has only been proven at the moment in two dimensions. And here we have an infinite dimensional transverse space here. I'm not too much afraid of this difficulty. I guess the real difficulty is that we are here in the situation a priori. As I explained, the two unstable I have two unstable eigenvalues which have crossed the value gamma zero. So they are on this level of the on this side, say on the imaginary axis, but not that far. Not that far. It means that the transverse contraction and also there is one which is getting close. So I mean the strongest, so this is the weakest stable eigenvalue which is coming close to the coming close to the imaginary axis is not that strong. So the transverse contraction here is not as strong as you are used to assume when you are able to prove that there is a non-light attractor. So I mean, to be able to find a theorem, a rigorous mathematical theorem, which is able to take this into account, would be a very good thing. So this is for the mathematics. From the biology point of view, well, we certainly would like to know whether this model is realistic or not. But they are even more interested in knowing which extra factors could be important. So, I mean, in a sense, certainly as you have seen, there are some values which are not quite realistic, especially this one, perhaps. This one, they are not so sure about this value. I mean, this is a kind of not so easy to study. But also, this may look a little too large. I agree. So, and certainly this is too small in relation to reality. But, well, first we have not explored, the exploration of parameter space was not what we did. But there are many factors that they would like to plug into the model. This is really the first step. And in particular, they are especially interested about the hereditary aspect. Meaning the that also maternal effect. Where actually you are not looking only at the structure of population according to age, which is what I did here, but you are also looking at the distribution of population according to many genetic or physical criteria and describing, so it's more function n, which does not depend only on time, but some other values which corresponds to hereditary or other characters for the others. Okay? So, that's all, and I hope I've tried to convince you that there were plenty of exciting mathematics to be done around that. Not much has been done yet. Huh? Thank you.